Welcome, welcome, welcome. Good morning, good morning, good morning. Can we give God a hand of praise? This is the day that the Lord has made. I will, you will, we will rejoice and be glad in it. Welcome to Abundant Grace Church, where love is. Amen. We thank God that this is our 12th year anniversary celebration. Hallelujah, hallelujah. We hope you are in expectation to receive what God has in store for you on today. We give God all the praise, the glory, and the honor. God has a word for us on today, all the way from St. Louis, Missouri. Pastor Terrence Newman coming. Amen. Get ready for the word on today. Come on, praise God. Hallelujah, hallelujah. We thank God for those that are watching on social media. Encourage someone, invite someone to watch and fellowship with us on today. Text them, call them, do whatever you need to do. Amen. God has a word for them on today. Our praise team is ready today, led by our very own pastor daughter, Cynthia Speed. Amen. They're going to set the table. They're going to set the house on fire. Amen. And we just thank God. We thank God. We thank God. We thank God for everyone here in person, those that are yet on the way. Amen. We're going to open up, amen, in a word of prayer. Can we all stand, amen, in the presence, amen, of the Almighty God, the great I Am, the everlasting Father, King of kings and Lord of lords. Amen. He is risen. He is here. Where two or three are gathered together in his name, he's in the midst. Yes. God inhabits the praises of his people. Are you ready to praise him?
Hallelujah.
Are you ready to magnify him? Yes. Are you ready to glorify him? Are you ready to lift him up? Yes. Hallelujah. Father, in the name of Jesus, God, we came, oh God, for no other reason, oh God, but to give you praise, to give you worship, to honor you, to bless you, to exalt you, Lord God, in the name of Jesus. Yes. God, we thank you for the privilege, oh God, that you've given us to see a brand new day, a day that we've never seen before. Thank you for your mercies that are brand new, Lord God. Thank you, God, that you are God and God alone, and that there is not another like you. God, we thank you, God, for being here in the midst. We thank you for your presence. We ask, oh God, that you overwhelm us, that you saturate us, oh God, that you fill us, God. Even the more, God, in the name of Jesus. God, because we came with an expectation, oh God. We came with a need, Lord God, in the name of Jesus. God, we thank you, God, for what you've done and what you're doing and what you're getting ready to do. We thank you, God, for the word that you've already prepared for us, God. We thank you that faith cometh by hearing and hearing by the word of God. In the name of Jesus, we thank you that every hearer of your word will be blessed. Every hearer of your word will be encouraged. Yes. That somebody, oh God, that hears your word today will be saved. Yes. In the name of Jesus. We're in expectation of miracles and signs, yes, and wonders on today, yes, God. Yes. In the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. God, we're in expectation, oh God, for praise to fill up this place, oh God. Yes. That it will be running over, oh God. Yes. From the inside out, God, that when people pass by, God, they will feel your presence in the name of Jesus. That your presence will draw them, God. We are celebrating 12 years, God. We thank you, God, for what you are doing and what you have done and what you're getting ready to do. We thank you, God, that, oh God, that they that labor, oh God, labor not in vain, oh God, for you have built this house, God. And you're yet building again. God, thank you for every member, Lord God, every leader, Lord God, past, present, and future, God, in the name of Jesus. God, we just bless you and we magnify you. We celebrate you. We honor you. We glorify you, God. We are partnering with you by our faith, oh God, that you're getting ready to do exceeding and abundantly above all, above somebody that is asking and above all that somebody is thinking, oh God, in the name of Jesus. As we hold up the shield of faith, God, we thank you that it will defeat all of the enemy's tricks and tactics and devices. All of his fiery darts are quenched in the name of Jesus. Be glorified. Let us be edified In Jesus' name we pray. Come on and give God a great big hand of praise. For he is the worthy one. Let everything that happened praise you the Lord. Come on and praise team.
All right, praise God. Hallelujah. Y'all look around the room, everybody. Look around the room. You see all of the blessed people of God. Amen. Praise the Lord. Come on, tell your neighbor, tap your neighbor, say, I'm a bride. Come on, you brothers too. I want to hear y'all. Let me hear the brothers say, I'm a bride.
I'm a bride.
Come on, say it a little louder.
I'm a bride.
Beautiful, don't we?
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus. We are beautified in the Holy Ghost. You know, we was talking about how, you know, we see some of our friends, you know, that don't know Christ, and they, you know, seem like age just be overrunning them, right? You know, we hear some statements about age, but we know the Holy Ghost keep us, don't he? Amen. So we are kept by the Holy Ghost. Praise God. We want you to find you somebody to love on this morning. If you don't feel comfortable embracing, just give them a fist bump, okay?
Amen, amen.
And go ahead on, brother, roll that track for us. Y'all get up and find you somebody to love on. Don't make us come out there and take you around.
Amen, hallelujah.
We love each other up in here.
Come on, y'all. Come on, y'all. Y'all go free one another. Yes, hallelujah. And y'all can sing on the way. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
Praise God. says yes. Amen. A lot of times, you know, when you start dealing with life, your soul ain't necessarily saying yes. And we have to remind ourselves that God is operating in our lives, even in the midst of our struggles, even in the midst of our trials. The Bible reminds us He never leaves us. He never forsakes us. And I love the scripture in Psalm 37 because it says, I've never seen the righteous forsaken, nor his seed begging bread. So we don't have to worry about all of the all of life's necessities. What we are reminded is that we have to worship God, serve God, amen, and all of the things will be added to us, right?
Amen.
So we want to seek God in all that he is, all his righteousness, and he'll add everything that we need.
Amen.
He said, I'll supply all of your needs.
Yeah.
But, you know, we find ourselves in the midst of ourselves. Because, you know, sometimes when I see me, I get in the Lord's way. I do. I get in his way. But I thank God that his mercies,
thank you, Jesus,
are new every morning and his compassions fail not. Amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah. Come on, my first lady. You're going to talk about that in spite of us. God loves us in spite of us.
In spite of me. She said it all, really. You know, sometimes we do get in God's way, but in the meantime, in spite of all that we do, you know, all the wrong that we do, God is still there to show us love. Amen?
Amen.
In spite of our mess,
amen,
he's always there. Amen? In spite of me. Y'all listen to these lyrics because they are so
your time, my first lady.
I got more flaws than
trials, and you got to remind yourself of what the Word of God says. Because the enemy is certainly going to be busy. I'm sure when my pastor dad and my mom was obeying God concerning this ministry, that the enemy was coming with all of his lies and all of his discouragements. And the same for my First Lady Newman and Pastor Newman. Hallelujah. You just got to go on and press in. Hang on in there and know that what God has for you is for you, and he's going to see you through. Hallelujah. All we got to do is trust him and hang on in there. Stand on his word. Remember his promises. And a yes and amen. Declare and decree that. Get your fighting scripture and stand on it and fight with it. Hallelujah. We got our baby saints with us today. We got Sister Isis Walker.
Amen.
She's going to talk to us this morning. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
Y'all.
Amen.
Amen.
you have to really put on your belt. Get your whole armor work. Shine that armor up. Get that word and crack it. And tell the devil what thus saith the Lord. He said we the head and not the tail. He said we above only and not beneath. He said we is the lenders and not the borrowers. Amen. So when you got a call on your life to do great ministry, you know all of this cost comes in, and how, what about the people and congregation? You know you gotta have support and giving and all of that. But God says, I will supply.
He will supply
of your needs.
Hallelujah.
According to his riches. His riches, y'all.
Yes.
You know how many of you saw that lottery thing for $1 billion? You know, a little bit of my flesh was like, ooh, Jesus. If I could just get a little bit of that.
Just a little bit.
A little bit. You know, for a minute, entertained getting me a ticket. But I didn't make it, y'all. So I just got to hang on in there. Hallelujah. Because you know what? God is going to see us through some things.
Yes, he will.
And somebody in the house shout victory.
Victory.
Hallelujah. But well, we're going to come at y'all like this morning.
All right. Old school,
I don't know how God's gonna do it, and I don't know when he's gonna fix it, but Lord, I know,
yes, God's gonna make a way for me,
yes, he will, I know he's gonna
do it.
Victory. Listen, y'all. Never told me how he's gonna
do it.
Fix it.
Fix it.
Fix it for me.
Fix it.
Fix
We getting ready for our steps of David to come on in and step on in and let God have his way.
Thank you.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
We are in a spiritual war.
Yes.
Good morning, AGC.
Good morning.
Feels good to be back up here. You know, Pastor got me this morning. I'm going to tell you how he got me. I waited all day yesterday during lunch. I'm like, please don't ask me to read my husband's bio. Please don't ask me to read my husband's bio. I don't like being up here. After lunch was through, got in the car. I was like, yes. He didn't ask me. Walked through the door this morning. Didn't ask me. And then he tiptoed, hey, sister, now. Hey. I'm like, here it come, please, no. Can you read your husband's bio? Oh. No. But here I am.
So,
I know, right? Okay, I'm about to tell y'all about this amazing husband of mine. Pastor Terrence O. Newman is a native of St. Louis, Missouri. He is the youngest of 16 siblings. He accepted Christ as a teenager and is a humble and gifted servant of God whose ultimate desire is to do the will of God.
Amen.
Pastor Terry has been married to his good thing.
Yes.
I'm gonna add a few more words because there's some missing. Beautiful.
Yes.
Loving.
Yes.
Amazing.
Uh-huh.
Best friend and wife, Latara Newman.
Yes.
For 14 years. He has 5 beautiful children: Terrence Newman Jr., Kelly Newman, Trenton Hamilton, Kamaya Newman, Talon Newman, and grandson Levi Jones. Pastor Terry served honorably in the United States Army for 15 years. His military career highlights were serving in the United States Army Field Band in Fort Meade, Maryland, and as a United States Army Drill Sergeant at Fort Leonard Wood, Missouri. Those skills assisted him in becoming a civilian Army recruiter in Richmond, Virginia. Some duty stations include Hawaii, Virginia, Egypt, Israel, and Germany. His education includes a Bachelor of Science in Homeland Security Emergency Management from Strayer University, a Master of Science in Public Safety Leadership from Capella University, Master of Arts in Urban Ministry from Grand Canyon University, and 5 CPE units of Clinical Pastoral Education from St. Luke's Hospital, in which he is presently serving as a chaplain. During the COVID-19 pandemic, Pastor Terry ministered to patients and staff at St. Luke's during a time when family members and friends could not visit due to strict COVID-19 protocols. As a result, Chaplain Terry at the bedside has served approximately 1,300 individuals, including patients, their families, members, and staff. Pastor Terry was baptized at Restoration Community Church under the leadership of Pastor Richard L. Dean. He joined Abundant Grace Church in 2017, where he served as a choir member, minister, youth minister, armor bearer, and elder under the mentorship of Stephen W. Jackson. In addition, Pastor Terry and First Lady Tara are stepping out on faith as founders of Now Faith, yes, World Ministries,
amen,
which they are currently in finalization. Now faith is the substance of things hoped for,
yes,
the evidence of things not seen. Please join me in welcoming the true man of God, Pastor Terrence Newman.
Amen. Amen. Take all that and I offer it up to God. Without him, none of that would be possible. God's been so grateful and so good to me. And so any accolade that I have at the end of the day, I offer that up to him, because he alone is worthy of all the praise, honor, and the glory. He alone deserves all that. So I just, first and foremost, just thank God in this house of this beautiful body of believers. God, you've been so great to all of us. So God first, amen. And then the man. And I just want to honor the man and woman of the house, Pastor Bishop Stephen Jackson. Because I've been texting that lately, and that's what it is. So I honor you, and I thank you from the bottom of my heart. Thank you, First Lady, for your fruit and the basket. Well, I'll tell you about that later. But thank you, man of God, again, for seeing something in me that I couldn't see in myself, for mentoring me every step of the way, for being involved in every part of ministry. You're going to be a great part of Now Faith World Ministries. So we're going to put you to work as well, just as you put us to work. So thank you. And thank you, pastors, Pastor Speed, and Pastor Casanall, and your wife, and everybody. And to you, y'all look so beautiful out there. Y'all look so beautiful. You smell so fresh. Everybody I hug smells so good. It's one thing to look good, but when you look good and smell good, it's something. It's just something. It just ain't even perfume. Just you took a shower today, and it smells nothing like shampoo. And nothing. I'm crazy, nothing like that. But I just love people who can look good. Black people are so beautiful. Brown people are so beautiful. Mexican Americans are so beautiful. We are some beautiful people. And I'm just gonna speak my mind and my truth today. You know how I feel. Of course, we're gonna speak God's truth. Y'all just beautiful. Don't let nobody tell you that. Y'all are so beautiful. And thank you, each and every one of you played a great role in my life, and I thank you. And I also want to honor Deacon Jackson and Mother Jackson at home listening. I just thank you because I understand that to raise a man like that, it took some work. You know, and I mean that, so I honor you. And I'll be done with these formalities in a second, but I do just want to recognize my family, my children, Trent, as they were mentioned, all my love you guys. Thank you for supporting me. Without you guys, I would not know where I would be or what I'll be doing. But thank you. And then to my good thing, my sweet thing, my beautiful loving wife. We're going on 15 years. We're going on 15 years. And I love you. Anybody who can put up with me for 15 years deserve a little credit.
Amen, amen.
Because I was crazy at one point in my life. But now I have Jesus. Amen. And where I go, you go. And we're going to share it together. But it's going to be God first. To my family, it's going to be God first.
That's all right.
Amen, amen. I won't be before you long on today. I just have a message for this, for the world, for this, especially for this ministry. I have a message, and I just celebrate these 12 years. Somebody give yourselves a hand for 12 awesome years. 12 years. Don't you know what can happen in a year? In 2 years? The 12 years. Amen. Amen. God be the glory. And I just want to tell you that we are older than the church. This ministry is older than 12. God's seen this before the beginning of time. If he knows everything and knows and go everywhere, he already knew that this will happen. The church started a long time ago. We are just an extension. 12 years. And before I start this sermon, Pastor, I just want to continue to encourage you. Don't look at what it looked like out here. The woman with an issue of blood, it took 12 years. It took some brokenness to get better. No, it took some brokenness to get better. No, it took some brokenness to get whole. 12 years. So you just hang in there. Don't worry about what you see. hang on in there. Amen. Because what you see, it ain't the final say. Amen. So if you ever find yourself getting discouraged, know that God has already have something for you better. And in your brokenness, he's going to make you whole. And just wait on him. And watch what he do. Because if he can do it for me, my, he can do it for you. So today I want to talk to this church. You know, the world is not playing with us. Satan is not playing with this church. Everybody is in this cancel cult. They trying to cancel everything. They canceling preachers. They canceling TV shows. Hold some stuff. Anything you say, they going to cancel you. And I wish they would try to cancel me, because I'm going to speak the word of God. I do not care. This is a war cry. You know, the army goes, whoa, you know what I'm saying? The Marines go, what they go, hoo-ah? You in the Air Force? What they go, hey you, or something like that? And the Navy just go, hey, but I'm just gonna leave it right there. But this is a war cry. We are not playing, we are at spiritual war up in here. We are in a war. And sometimes it just don't take just, everybody just think that God is a God of love. Yes, he is, but our God is a warring God. And he's a warring God as well. So I'm not trying to come up here and sound like anybody else. I'm not trying to come up here and say, oh, give your life to God because God is going to love you. And if you say, I'm not doing that today. Because our children's lives are at stakes here. Our lives are at stakes here. You know, everybody want to counsel you. They ain't counseling this. They need to go get some counseling. Because when it comes to the world and God, the world ain't have God first. Somebody say God first.
God first.
When you think of Jesus, and I love participation, when you think of Jesus, what do you think of? Anybody? Say it out loud.
God's
perfect love.
Salvation.
Holy.
Prince of peace.
Salvation. Faithful. Look at that. Faithful.
Yes.
Amen.
Counselor.
Yes. Amen. Look at that. Y'all know the word. Y'all been reading it. Everybody think that Jesus, you know, you get this picture of Jesus and this image. Your image of Jesus in your mind is this man walking around, and I'll say it, this white man walking around. I'm so peaceful. I love you so much. And Jesus casting out demons and confronting the devil. Jesus was not a punk.
No,
let me try to tell you.
No, he ain't.
Anybody can catch face to face with Satan. Come on now. If y'all don't know me, don't be shocked by my preaching. I'm looking at this cover over here. God bless y'all. I come to tell the truth today. So the title of this is, Don't Imagine That I Came to Bring Peace on Earth. No, rather a sword. And the subtitle is, I don't know if y'all watch Different Strokes back in the days with Little Arnold. When you hear that and you're like, dang, Jesus, you've been talking about all this peace. Then my subtitle is, what you talking about, Jesus? What you talking about? Because you're so peaceful. Jesus, you're so peaceful. So let's turn, I should have it up here. Let's go to Matthew 10:34 through 49. And I'm just going to read this and then we'll get into the rest of it. It said, don't imagine that I came to bring peace on earth, no, rather a sword. And if y'all from the ghetto is sword, you know the W is silent, but I won't hold that against you. Don't hold it against me. Yes, Jesus came to unify his church. Yes, he did. He came to get us unified and uniform and get us saved and be our counselor and all those great things y'all said, but he also came with a sword. Well, this ain't lining up with what I thought about you, Jesus. My image of you, Jesus, was you so peaceful. You so loving. But he came with this sword, and we're going to find out what that is in a minute, folks. So I just want to address those great assumptions, the great misunderstanding that we have when we talk about Jesus. And I always say in my CPE chaplain supervisor gave me some great power when she said, check your assumptions. Check that thinking. That assumptions is your thinking. You know what they say about assumptions, right? Y'all know what they say about assumptions? I don't know. Y'all keep that to y'all self. I don't know. Y'all know what it says. Don't put it on me because I'm not saying it. But when you assume things, it becomes a great misunderstanding. So we have to check our assumptions. How do we check our assumptions about our Lord? We go in the Bible and we read it. We get clarity. It says above all thy getting, we need to get an understanding. So the Bible tells us in Proverbs 4:7, it says, wisdom is the principal thing. Therefore, get wisdom. And with that, get understanding. So wisdom can be learned, guys. It can be learned. Wisdom comes through listening and listening to the truth of God. Wisdom develops good judgment and common sense. Hello, common sense. So don't let nobody tell you and the next person tell me or pray that, going to get an education and all that. It's part of it. Yes, and. It's never this or that. It's yes, and. That's common sense. Using revelation knowledge with worldly knowledge. And as long as it leads to God, but when you get your education and you use it towards the kingdom of God, it's yes and. So don't let nobody put you down about your education, because you need that common sense to navigate through the world too. I see some Christians just dumb as a box of rocks. Don't know how to maneuver through the city, getting robbed. I know how to maneuver through the neighborhood. I'm from the hood. When you look at me, you ain't looking at no square. I know how to move. You got to have some common sense. Revelation knowledge. Yes, and. Wisdom will guard you and lead you to greater honor. It's going to be a while. To greater honor. Wisdom will lead you in different places to greater honor. You heard it. First, I was on the choir. Then all these things happened. And now God said, here's your ministry. And then wisdom will place a crown upon your head. A tiara for you, woman. And a crown for us. And that gray hair when you get old, that crown that I'm not dying. And for you brothers who don't have it, we'll give you that crown as well. We'll give you that right there. I love it. It's all included up in here. But above all things, I want y'all to get wisdom. I want you to understand there are some things that you have to unlearn. All this church stuff that you're hearing that sounds good is not all necessarily good for you. So, on the count of three, somebody say, listen, Linda. 1, 2, 3.
Listen, Linda.
Listen, Linda. Y'all better listen on today. Amen. Amen. So, why do we assume that Jesus is the Prince of Peace? Just what we said. Because of the Bible. You know, anybody know that Christmas song, Hark the Herald Angels Sing? Choir, go sing that for me.
Hark the Herald Angels Sing. Glory. On earth and mercy.
That's enough. So every time we think of Jesus, we think of baby Jesus. And baby Jesus is so peaceful, ain't he? Somebody go to that next slide. He's so peaceful in his little manger, not knowing that the manger ain't some wood. That it was a tomb, really. I really want y'all to research that. That the manger wasn't a piece of grass and dirt. It's where they fed animals, but it represented a tomb. From the womb to the tomb. Jesus was hanging on in there right from the beginning, getting the protection of God, because they knew who he was. But a lot of people thought that this new king, this new Jesus, would come on this grand horse and would bring peace. They thought he was coming in on a horse like this, but he came in on that mule. So humbly. So humbly. So I just want y'all to check y'all assumptions. Somebody say peace.
Peace.
Somebody say peace.
Peace.
So there's different kind of pieces. For you women, there's hair pieces. For you man too, we get the hair pieces. That's the piece that we have in God. He's the Prince of Peace, the reconciliation. And there's a gun. That's a piece. But today we're here to talk about
peace of God.
There you go. So somebody say peace.
Peace.
Somebody say peace.
Peace.
So every time I do this, I want y'all to say peace as loud as y'all can, okay? I want y'all to help me out on today. So why do we assume that Jesus came to bring
peace?
We assume that because we only got a
peace
of the story, and we filled in the blanks
When you read only the Old Testament, you only get a
piece
of the story. When you only read the New Testament, you only get a
piece
of the story. If you only read and just read not to get an understanding through wisdom and revelation knowledge, you only getting a
piece
of the story. You're only getting the peace, and you satisfied with that.
Peace.
And this is why we can't get no
peace.
Because you're operating in false
peace.
And thinking it's true.
Peace.
And you carrying your
peace.
To keep the
peace.
Instead of listening to the Prince of
Peace.
Somebody say hallelujah.
Yeah.
Somebody say hallelujah. We're talking about peace today.
Yeah.
And some may assume that Jesus came to bring peace, but he said it. And it comes from Bible verses like 2 Corinthians 13:11. Finally, my brothers and sisters, rejoice. Strive for full restoration and encouragement for one another. Be of one mind. Live in peace. And in God, love and peace will be with me. And then Matthew 5:9, blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. See, we get this assumption wrong of peace. Peace disrupts. Because when you're preaching the word of God, I'm going to show you that your own family is going to turn on you. If they are not with that. If they ain't with that program, they're going to turn on you. Watch this. I'm going back to Matthew. Listen to this. It says, do not imagine that I came to bring peace on earth, no, rather a sword. I have come to set man against his father and daughter against his mother. And daughter against his daughter-in-law. And mother against her daughter-in-law. And mother-in-law. A man's worst enemy will be right in his own home. If you love your father and your mother more than you love me, you are not worthy of being mine. Or if you love your son and daughter more than you love me, you are not worthy of being mine. If you refuse to take up your cross daily and follow me, you are not worthy of being mine. If you cling to your life, you will lose it. But if you give it up to me, I will save it. He said, I did not come to bring peace. And you say, how do I love my daughter more than I can love you, God? Well, can you just imagine this pregnant woman? I ain't never been pregnant, but those who you had babies before, as soon as you learned that you had a baby in your belly, you was like, oh my God, I'm pregnant. And what you start to do? You love that baby before you. I'm talking about if Jay said 9 weeks, you in love with that baby. You stop smoking. You stop drinking. You start taking those prenatal vitamins. And then when your stomach starts to show, you walking around in that sundress in the summer because you're just hot just from breathing. And you're loving that baby. You go to bed. You're eating the right foods because everything gives you indigestion. You are so in love with that child. 6 months come around and you're showing. And everybody's saying, ooh, I thought you was fat. But that's a baby in there. And you just want to smack them, don't you? But you, with your beautiful self, you're walking around and you're loving that baby. This is what I'm trying to say. Despite of how you look, despite of the swelling, despite of what people are saying to you, you are loving that child. And then when you come to the end and you in that room and them labor pains come, for a second you're like, oh no, God, take them back. It hurts too much pain. But when that baby is born, you forgot about the labor pains, and now you in love with that child. But all the while, you never called on God. And this is how you can love your child greater than you can love God. It's so easy. It's so easy to fall in love with your own kids greater than you love God. But then that child goes over grandma's house who's in the Word. You know the grandma that wakes up listening to old school gospel. You know that grandma that sing them old school hymns. The grandma that put the Vaseline on your face when you go out in the cold. You know the grandma like that write you the letters. You know what I'm talking about. The one who had the pinto beans on the stove. When you say, ain't nothing to cook, you know, you better go look in that refrigerator. If you got some ice cubes in there, you got something to eat. That kind of spiritual grandmother. And you take your baby over grandma's house. And now she's giving this baby the word. And you are like, stop sending my baby home. All he want to do is come home and say thank you, Jesus, and hallelujah. And it's disrupting your spirit and disrupting your peace because this child loves God more than he loves his mother. Hallelujah. And now, so go to the next slide. I want you to go to the one where you see the families with the division. See that? And that's what happens. That's that same little baby that was in that belly.
that was that same seed in that man, but now they divided because that sword is division. God, Jesus came to bring division. You understand me? Because it ain't no middle ground. If you ain't down with them, it's going to be some division in the family. Family members ain't going to act right. When you pray, they going to get all squirmy and screwed. They ain't going to want to hang around you no more. That's what happens when you are divided, when you're not equally yoked in marriage. Division happens. So what I'm trying to tell you, disciples, did everybody go to Mecca, Pastor? Not everybody, but how many people in here went to Mecca? By show of hands, how many of you went to Mecca? Now, if you don't know this question, we're going to go back. Pastor said, we are all,
somebody said,
we are all disciples. We are all disciples. Y'all go back. Somebody said it. We are all disciples. Are disciples meant to sit in the front pew? No. What are disciples meant to do? They're meant to go out with great authority and power from God. They ain't meant to sit here. So if you are a disciple, God is going to send you out. And the reason why I'm telling you this message, because even your own family members will come against you. Your friends at church will come against you, even if they don't have it. They get, you know, you wonder why, like, you're supposed to be my sister. We're supposed to make peace with our brothers and sisters. But this world is going to eat you up because you love God, because you're preaching the gospel, the good news. Hallelujah. So this ain't for the squeamish of heart. And this is what I'm trying to prepare you. We're in a world where we got all kinds of things going. You know, gay people want to counsel us. People who say they want to identify with other things. I mean, it's just everybody wants to counsel us. We have to stop apologizing to this world. I would see a pastor apologize for 5 minutes before he started a sermon on sexual immorality. I'm so sorry. I just love everybody before I get into this message. I just love you so much. And stop apologizing like that. If you're wrong apologizing, we know your character. We know that you love us. But stop apologizing. There's nothing to apologize. We are at war.
Amen.
Now, we love our enemy, but we don't have to apologize to him now.
Amen.
I'm talking to every minister, pastor, everybody in this world. Speak your peace of God.
Amen.
Walk in his shoes. Speak your peace. Stop apologizing to people. Because this life, this disciple life is something. Mm-hmm. You have gang members that would die for a color.
Yeah.
Think about that.
Yeah.
You have military people that would die for this nation. Think about that. You have healthcare workers that would die going into a hospital now for all these diseases that's going on. I want y'all to think about that. You got people that have died down for the cause, but ask yourself, disciples, will you die for Christ? Let that marinate. Let that marinate. Will you die for Christ? So y'all thought this was going to be a good old Kumbaya, my Lord, Kumbaya, Kumbaya, my Lord, Kumbaya. Everybody. See, y'all thought it was going to be that kind of message, but what I'm trying to prepare you is for this world. We need to love each other with all our, with everything. Love God with everything, and we must, that vertical and that horizontal relationship must look the same.
Yeah.
Do you understand? If you say you love God,
yes,
you got to love one another.
Amen.
If you say it, but know that we are at war, like my sister said, this is a war cry. Because when you speak the gospel, the peace, this misunderstanding that we had about this peace that Jesus is talking about is our reconciliation back to God. We were at peace with God, with Adam, because God walked with Adam. He talked with Adam.
Yes.
Adam didn't even know he was naked, just walking. Breeze just all in his butt, just walking and talking. Adam was good, he was talking to God. But soon as they sinned, oh, wait a minute. And he disrupted something. He disrupted the peace with God. But Jesus came back to reconcile that. That's why Jesus is the great mediator. He came to restore that relationship back with us and God. That peace with God, not the peace with the world, not the peace with the world, but that peace with God. So when you accept God and when you preach the gospel and we accept Christ, you were reconciled back into God. And when you don't, when you look like the world loved you, didn't they? When you look like the world and dance like the world, they love you. Girl, you going out? Yeah, I'm going to go out this weekend. I'm going to church on Sunday, though. Well. Next week, girl, you going out? I'm kind of tired, but I'm going to go on church Sunday, though. Girl, you going out? No, I'm going on church on Sunday, though. And then next week, you don't even get a phone call because you no longer look like the world. Amen. Them people don't call you no more. You know that. Yeah. They stop messing with you. And when you call them, it's been 10 years. I just want to see how you're doing. Girl, I'm going out. Doing the same old thing. Doing the same old thing. But we are marching towards glory. We are reconciled through our great mediator called Jesus Christ. Thank you, Lord. So I just want to read Luke because it mirrors what we were preaching. It says, I have come to bring fire on earth. And oh, how I wish it were kindled now. This is the word of Jesus. Jesus is saying, I got this cross to go to. And oh, I don't want to go on this cross. That flesh part of him was fighting. He wanted. Remember, he sweated like blood. But he knew what he had to do. And he said, oh, how I wish, as soon as I fulfill this mission, oh, how I wish. This world will come to an end because God is going to come with fire this time. Oh, how I wish he was here. But Jesus had to partake this baptism of the cross and undergo it. And he said, I can't even start this process till this is over with, and I don't want to do it. But I'm going to do it because I love you. Because I'm Jesus. I'm all man and I'm all God. I am the great I am. They're going to kill me. And you're no greater than me, Christians. If they kill me, guess what? They're going to kill you too. So disciples, what I'm saying, when you get sent out, know that the world is going to try to persecute you. Know that they want you. But this is the price we pay. Anybody still want to be a Christian today? Anybody still want to be a disciple today? I'm trying to tell you, it ain't for the faint of heart. But God will give you everything. He will equip and empower you with everything that you need. I tell you, it ain't easy because everybody would do it. It ain't hard because nobody would do it. But God equips and empowered us with the Holy Spirit. Amen. And he leads and he guides us and shows us what to do. And then he says, do you think that I came to bring peace on earth? No, I tell you. Can anybody tell me what this sword is? It's division. He came to divide you from the world. Hallelujah. There ain't no middle ground. There ain't no middle ground. There's family members who suffering right now because they're following Jesus and they can't understand it. And they're hurt. And they want to give up. But I tell you, hang in there because light exposes the dark. Yeah. Don't you know that light exposes the dark even in your family? Y'all know what I'm talking about. Yes, yes. Whoever seen a roach before? I'm serious. No, whoever seen a roach before? When you see them, where you see them at? Right when you turn on the lights. You see roaches right when you turn on the lights. They scatter because they don't like light. So the light that we carry is going to expose the darkness in the world. It's going to expose that dark person in our family, at our job. It's going to expose everything. Demons are like roaches. The only, we not mingle our light with darkness. We not go out to the club. The only time we deal with darkness is when we are transforming. Because we have to go out and do the word. So we can take a person from darkness into the light. That's the only time we deal with darkness is when we are transforming it, transcending through it, and bringing whoever in that darkness back into the light. And that's when it gets dangerous. You know when you walk the street to go get your friend, your husband, your sister, and your brother. You know that kind of danger. That kind of danger of preaching peace in the world and dying like Martin Luther King did. That kind of danger. That kind of danger from going to countries like Egypt and Iraq and preaching the gospel and dying for it. That kind of danger. Anybody still want to be a Christian on today? And there ain't no middle ground. Oh, there ain't no middle ground. But this is so confusing because he says, God says, honor your mother and your father, but your mother and your father ain't down with Christ, and we're going to honor them. You can honor them from a distance. Don't stop bringing your grandbabies over. Don't stop doing that. Still pay the light bill online. You can honor somebody from a distance.
Amen.
You don't have to live under the roof.
Amen.
Once you get your own, go ahead, but you should continue to honor your mother and your father, because that is the first promise, y'all, that has results, because you will live a long life.
Amen.
That's the first commandment with results.
Amen.
You know, you honor your mother and your father. And there you go. Amen. So we can honor our family from a distance. Honor your mother and father from a distance. Respect them.
Amen.
Because it says the world hates disciples. They hate us. In John 15 and 18, they hate us. If the world hates you, Jesus said, if the world hates you, keep in mind that they hated me first. If the world hates you, keep in mind that they hated me first. If you belong to the world, it will love you as its own. We just read that. And it is you. It is that you don't belong. You do not belong to the world. But I have chosen you out of the world. So God knew you before you even were. And he had something for you because he knew what you would do in this world. And a servant is not greater than the master. If they persecute me, Jesus, God, they're going to persecute you too. Anybody still want to be a Christian on today? Anybody still want to be a disciple on today? Hallelujah. We're going to get persecuted. We're going to get spit on. We're going to get cussed out. And it's happening right now. You can't even pray in school, but what's happening in the schools? So much killing. When you remove God from anything. They say church and state. But when you remove God from anything, you best to know that hell is going to fill it up. So keep your babies prayed up. Let your babies be the only ones praying up. Now, if you want another 12 years, you stay prayed up. If you want another 12 years, know that you will be persecuted. If you want another 12 years, get in your word. If you want another 12 years, walk the walk that you're talking. If you want another 12 years, you give God praise. If you want another 12 years, because this ain't for the faint of heart. Deacon, can you come up here, please? This job, this is a lifetime. This ain't no check in and check out type job there, Pastor.
Amen.
I told you when Pastor gave me that book called Don't Drop the Mic When I Left, I wanted to give it back to him. It's a book about preaching, and that when you mention somebody, that you continue the word of God. And when he gave me that book, I wanted to leave it right here because I know what I'm in for. And it ain't no picnic. But what I want to tell you is, Pastor, stay back there, Deacon. Somebody with that, so they can see us, you might have to pull the iPad back some. What I want you to, somebody saying today, somebody said magnify the Lord. Somebody said that on today, right? I heard it. And we don't magnify God with a microscope. Do everybody understand that? We do not magnify God with a microscope. What do we magnify with a microscope? Things that are what? Small. We take things that we can't even see and we magnify it. So we don't magnify God like that. We magnify God with a telescope. Why? Because it puts things back into perspective. We know Saturn is huge, but when we look at it, it looks like a tiny dot. But when we get that telescope, we were like, man, that thing big. So we have to put God back into perspective in our lives. And you know when that's going to happen, when things are going to get disrupted. Peace disrupts. Peace is not all this kumbaya moment, but people are going to come at you. Stuff is going to happen, but you need to keep the faith. So we have turned our backs on God. We have took my perspective. And God, look at the devil just beating us up. Come on, Pastor. Y'all know you watch wrestling. The devil beat us down. He got us in a stronghold. And then we yell out, oh, God. And now we turn and we look at our God. Hold on. Go back. I'm going to take one step. When I move, you move. Just like that. And this demon trying to keep me back. But I'm trying to go forward. And God is seeing me. I'm trying to put God back into perspective in my life. God, I'm calling out your name. See, God is so big in my life. And when I get my clutches on God, the enemy has no hold on me no more. I'm going to hang on in there. I'm going to walk with Christ. I'm going to keep moving. What you going to do? What are you going to do? You're going to follow Christ.
And when that enemy comes back to attack you, when he comes back to attack you, God has got your back. I no longer have to look this way. I can keep stepping because I'm walking with God. Somebody hang on in there. The fight is not mine. It's the Lord. The fight is not mine. It's the Lord. The fight is not mine. It's the Lord. Hallelujah. Hang on. Hang on in there. Hang on in there. Hang on. In our life. Folks, just like my man said, I love wrestling. What are you going to do when God gets a hold of you? What are you going to do? Put God back into perspective in your lives, people. It's the only way we're going to make it. We are at war. This is our war cry. And there's power in this name. Jesus. There's power in that name,
yes, it is.
Jesus. Because God did not give us a spirit of fear, mm-hmm. but of power, love, and a sound mind. There's power in the name of Jesus. Somebody just give God a hand praise just right now. Thank you for him. Just for him. Thank you, Jesus. Not me, but God. But God, because he inhabits your praise. Anybody still want to be a Christian today?
Yeah.
Well, go out. I had to leave the nest. It was not comfortable. You want another 12 years? You can go out. You want another 12 years, Pastor? Well, keep it. You know, like you said, if earth delay is coming, if God delay is coming, I'm sorry, and the creek don't rise, keep sending them out. Keep teaching them Mecca, because you don't know who you're raising up. You don't know who you're raising up. You don't know what that person is going to do. It ain't about what you see here. When you send them out, it's when you see the true power. God gave them power and authority to cast out demons and to heal the sick. And the reason why healing is not happening now is because we don't believe it. But I've seen it. I've worked in a hospital and I've seen people come from death. I've seen people who don't even love God say the name of Jesus. I've seen them sitting down with him just saying, what is that that I feel on you? That's the love of God. You don't always have to preach your Bible, just your ministry of reconciliation. Your ministry of presence speaks enough. Because when you walk, remember, you're walking with God. Don't let nobody discourage you. If you want 12 more years, we got some work to do. It's not going to be easy. It's not going to be hard. But God ain't sending you into a tank fight with a knife. He ain't doing it. Satan has no power. He has power, but is limited. He has great power, but is limited. But guess what? Greater is he.
Yes,
uh-huh.
He
come on now. You have authority to cast out every demon.
Yes.
Y'all want another 12 years. Y'all want another 12 years. Y'all seen that 12 years, that movie 12 Years a Slave, where people went through hell for even longer than that, their lifetime. But you have to go through and get broken in order to get healed. You understand? What I'm really trying to say is that we are walking wounded. You understand? We are walking wounded, therefore we have no anointing, we have no oil, we have no power to heal because we don't believe in it. People are preaching without power. They have no oil in the lamp. They're walking wounded. But Jesus said, they're going to hit you and beat you, and you're going to be wounded, but you're going to be wounded healers. You understand that? We're not walking wounded. We are wounded healers. Because wasn't Jesus a wounded healer? And when he came back, even in his glory, he bared the wounds of the cross. Did he not? He was a wounded healer. Even in his glory, in his perfect body, he had nails. He had holes in his hands, pierced in his side, holes in his feet. But guess what? He was still walking and healing. And he gave authority to us, to his church. He's the head of the church. Somebody mentioned bride. So that's why we celebrate today. We celebrate today. We have to graduate from being a walking wounded
and to the wounded healing. Because Jesus was. And when I see that, I'm going to know it's him. Anybody still want to be Christian today? Yeah. Anybody still want to go out in the world and preach the word of God and go on your job and risk your job because somebody says you can't say that I'm a this and I'm a that? You still going to say I'm God's child? Amen. Come on now. The enemy don't have power over us.
Amen.
God has given us everything. Everything.
Yes.
He gave his only begotten son for this world.
Yes.
And I'm going to end right here, Pastor. When I mention world, I don't mean just when you go outside. I really want y'all to understand this. I want to empower you with something. The battle is right here, right?
Yes.
If you have the mind of the world, a sinful mind, the mind of the flesh, I don't want to do right. I want to reject God. That it starts up here. This is where the battlefield is, right here. But oh boy, if you have the mind of the Spirit, you got everything. And our battle is right here. So no matter what it looks like, no matter what it feels like, no matter how defeated you are, no matter who's hurting you, God has the final say. I know you're hurting. I know you're hurting. I'm hurting. I have a son in prison. A son with life in prison. That hurts. But I'm not going to stop praising God.
Amen.
I have people all over St. Louis. So my people, I would be remiss if I didn't mention this, who are under flood waters in St. Louis on our street Maple. And I pray for you guys. God bless you. Hold on. I pray that the government as well help our people, our black and brown people, just like they help everybody else. I can't come in here and not speak justice. This is the things we fight for. So I love you guys at home. Hang in there. Until AGC. It almost feels like, when I read The Great Fall and the way, it almost feels like that because everybody's leaving church. But I see more people in Walmart. I see more people in the grocery store.
Right.
I see more people doing other stuff.
Yep.
But this is the one thing that we push back because we don't want COVID. And guess what? When COVID settles down, it's gonna be something else like the monkeypox. And then it's gonna be the Egyptian chickenpox or something like that, some name. And then we're gonna have these mosquitoes. They're gonna call them dinosaur mosquitoes. And they're gonna say, if you go to church, they're gonna kill you. Don't be around your people. Have all this stuff going on, but you need to understand, if you're going to go one place, this is the place you need to be.
Amen.
I'm here to tell you. If you're going to go one place, this is the place you need to be. If you can go to work, this is the place you need to be to edify one another.
Amen.
To edify one another.
Yes.
To build each other up.
Yes.
Don't let nobody tell you. But this is so important that you know what? I want to ask y'all to promise me something. I normally wouldn't do this because I'd be like, you got to tell me what it is first. Even when my wife tells me to do that, promise me you're going to do it, is always a trick. Guys, go out this month, get one person, invite them to church to get the word, not to come to see pastor, not to come to see the dance ministry, not to do all that, but to get the word. Because we just said we're disciples.
Yes.
We got to go out. And y'all have everything that y'all need. Y'all have social media. Learn how to use that stuff. Learn how to get on there and get these people. Because that's where them kids at. Them kids don't even come outside no more. They on social media. Well, I don't have enough legs to walk and ring every doorbell. Get on that thing and start calling them in. And trust God that he will bring them in. That's my challenge to you, church. Y'all ain't exempt. With due respect. With due respect. Go get them. Go gain them. And I'm about to end this, but I do want to say one more thing before I do. It was a year ago, tomorrow, August the 1st, in which I had my last sermon in this ministry when we were leaving. a year ago. Tomorrow, this very day, August the 1st. And I never thought in a million years I'll be invited to preach at any anniversary. I was just complaining. Nobody invites me to anniversaries and to my wife. And then a week later, pastor, God impressed upon my heart to bring you up to El Paso. I told my wife, get them tickets. Get them right now while they cheap. Get them tickets. Girl, you gotta get that hotel and get that rental car. Get them tickets. I'm coming up there to preach because I love you. God bless each and every one of you. And I'm gonna tell you this. There's this thing called a sinner's prayer that preachers and pastors do. I'm gonna tell you that there is nothing that I can say, no rhythm or rhyme or words to make you come to repeat. It has to be right here first. So when you are saying that God has already moved in your heart, becomes from the abundance of the heart, speak of the mouth. I'm talking to you out there too. And then it says, repent and be baptized. You can repeat whatever I say, but you have to repent and be baptized. Yes, and. It's not just repeating what I say, but if you don't know Christ, we are in our last days. We are in our last seasons. And even if you don't meet God, if he don't come today and swoop you up right now to these clothes, then you don't know how long you got anyway. See, this is the thing. You don't know when your last day is going to be. You don't know. We serve a great and mighty God. We serve the Most High God. We serve an awesome God. Amen. We serve the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, the Holy One, the Great I Am. We serve the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. Oh, we serve a great morning star. Not the devil's light that burned out, but God's light that burned forever. We serve that kind of God. We serve a God that gave his Son, his only begotten Son, so we can have the everlasting life, the eternal life, the quality of life. Because you're going to live forever anyway. It's just going to be how you live. We serve a God that loves us first. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Y'all deaf. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Let everything. I'm talking about, Pastor, if you got pigeons on the roof, let them praise them in song. If you got snakes crawling on the leaf, let them praise them with their breath. Because every time you breathe, you're praising them anyway. You're praising your Creator. And if you don't know God and you want to have an encounter with God, if you want him to be your father, your Abba, your friend, your confidant, your companion, your protector, then just symbolically just raise your hand and say, oh Lord, I love you. And I believe in the work of your Son, Jesus the Christ. And I accept you, Jesus, as my Lord and Savior. And I know it's not going to be easy, but I'm going to hang on. Not just to anything, I'm going to hang on to you. Lead and guide me. Show me what to do. And let your spirit now dwell in me. Oh, Holy Spirit, for those who never have you, we welcome you, and we welcome you right now. Now go, repent, and be baptized. Go and sin no more. If you land in a bed and you unmarried, can I just be real? Get up. If you're doing drugs and you just gave your life to God, go get some help. Get off. If you've went far astray, repent and be baptized. Turn from your ways, because there's no middle ground. But if you just, in your heart, I can't put you in hell and I can't put you in heaven. But in your heart, if you believe that you have given your life to Christ, then we now pronounce you saved in the mighty name of Jesus. Let all the angels in heaven rejoice, and somebody give a praise. If there's any sick among you today that won't praying over, if there's any sick among you today, please come up. Because I believe that God is a healing God. If there's any one of you going through some things that you can't handle, you come on up. You come up. For those of you at home, we praying over your body, we praying over your mind, we pray over your spirit, we pray over you, we pray that God bless you. With everyone. Don't wait to get your healing. Anybody that Jesus ever healed, he empowered them. Anybody that Jesus ever healed, Pastor, in faith, he told him to do something. He told a man to pick up his bed and go. And I'm just going to ask, do you believe that God can heal you? Do you believe you heal? Do you believe that God can heal you? Well, then you are healed. Because your faith has to meet God's healing. Anybody Jesus ever healed, he empowered them, get up, wash the mud out of your eye. And if you never got up to wash the mud, will you be healed? God has made you whole. He made the woman of the issue of blood whole. He didn't just fix her issues in her body. He made her whole again. Do you believe that God is going to heal you? Not just you, but your situation. You step over here. In the name of Jesus, we just give you all the praise, honor, and glory. We just ask you to bless from the crown of their head to the sole of their feet, Father God. In the mighty name of Jesus, whatever it is, whatever is on their heart, they already said they came to you in faith. Father God, in the mighty name of Jesus, whatever it is, finances, whatever it is, marriage, whatever it is, health, Father God, whatever it is, job, God, we are blessed just because you're in our lives. We don't have to have money and perfect health to be blessed. We are blessed because we have you, Father God. Continue to bless and keep them, Father God. Continue to bless their families, Father God. Everything within them, Father God. Continue to bless them, O Lord. These are your children. These are your children, God. So we thank you, Father God. Oh God, there's nothing that I can do or say, but it's you. Let them continue to walk in faith, and no matter what it looks like, my beautiful family, no matter what it looks like, God has the final say. You've gone through so much. You have been through so much, and nobody knows. Nobody feels what you feel. And you wake up and you don't feel beautiful, when you don't feel worthy. When you feel, why me? It's okay to ask God questions, because that's how we get near to him. Don't let nobody lament. Don't let nobody tell you. Your relationship with God is just that. But I believe that you are healed. And I know that healing is a process. And we are under construction. So Father God, I just thank you. In the name of Jesus, we give you all the praise, honor, and glory. In Jesus' mighty name. Thank God and amen. Amen. God bless you. My first lady and pastor, please. Can you come up here, please? First lady, guitar. God bless you. For those of you at home, let your faith meet God's healing. I would be so remiss if I didn't do this, and I'm going to get out y'all way. Y'all up. In the name of Jesus. I just feel God's presence in this place.
We just want to say we truly thank God for both of you and just being back here. Thank you for inviting us to come back, and it brings back so many wonderful, amazing memories. Just watching SOD up here dance, I started to cry, tear up a bit, and I'm just in awe of the way you welcome everyone into this AGC family. And I'm thankful to be a part of it. Whether I move, I'm still gonna be a part of it. No matter where we go. And we appreciate you guys so much. We miss all of you. Everyone here has a special place in our heart. We just want to let you know that I love you forever and ever. That ain't, I'm not going to do it. And that's not going to change. And we truly miss you guys.
My bishop, my second first lady, First Lady Jackson, Bishop Jackson. I just want to let y'all know that the hospitality and coming here was simply amazing. I've never been treated like this, and it brings me to tears. Like, I've never been treated like this in my life. I feel like I'm your son. It ain't even what you brought into the room, it's just the thought of it. And I know you put hard work into everything that you do in excellence. I know you do. And that's you. Man of God, I'm not gonna drop this mic. You are my mentor, you are my friend, and I just thank you for this opportunity to stand before you and what God did in you. I am so moved by your hospitality. You almost made me not want to go home. But I have to go. God bless you. And if you want 12 more years, don't worry about what you see out here. Because we're going to take this walk together. We're going to take this together. And just listen to God. It's never this or that. It's yes and. First Lady, I know it's hard taking care of a ministry man. But God has equipped and empowered you. And I know you don't take stuff either. But we honor each other. We honor each other's. That's what we do. We honor each other. So I just thank you. I thank God for you, and I love you. And I mean that from with all my heart, not from the bottom, with everything in me. And if you guys need anything, you let this family know, and we will come on. We will get them tickets. Amen. This is not for the church. This is for you guys.
Amen.
I'm not rich and all that, but you take half, and then you take half, and you buy his dinner with your half, and you buy her dinner with your half, and y'all become whole, and y'all dinner making, eating, whatever. But we say thank you. We thank you from the bottom of my heart. And thank you, guys. Thank you so much, Pastor Speed, Pastor Kevin. She always calling to encourage me. My brother G back there, Deacon Cox. My brother, Brother Villanueva, texted me a text that he just did not even know. But you were right on time, brother. I love each and every last one of you. Where's Francis? Stay away from my daughter, boy. I ain't playing. I'm real up in here. Y'all seen me do that when he walked in earlier? I've been doing that since I known him. I be sending him emojis. I ain't lost contact. I send him emojis with those fists. And you get a job and you go come back something with a uniform on or something with some flowers. And then, but right now, you know, God bless you guys. Hand is over.
I want to give God a great big hand to play. Praise again. Amen. Come on, give God a great big hand of praise. Hallelujah.
Amen. 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 To God be the glory. Amen.
I just want to say this before we let our viewing audience go. Amen. Just want to thank God for Pastor Terrence Newman. Amen. From the moment I met him, something just connected, and I never knew how that God was gonna bring it to this point and beyond. And I am humbled by his friendship. I'm humbled by his humility. I'm humbled. He's my Timothy. Amen. I thank God for putting me in his life, and God giving me the opportunity and the privilege of befriending him and loving him and pouring into him. But what he's declared over me in this ministry, I declare a double portion more for you in your ministry. Amen. For the glory of God. Amen. Your faithfulness, your humility, your obedience to walk away from a great paying job, beautiful home here in El Paso, things going well, First Lady had a great job, and kids doing well in school, and then to let it go for the call to St. Louis. God is doing exceeding abundantly, a greater, more beautiful home. A greater job. There's no greater job than pastoring. I don't care what you can be president of the United States. It does not compare to being a pastor. Blessing First Lady with another job, getting ready to start up here, what, next week? Getting ready to start up next week, amen. Already in charge, amen. Getting ready to hire her own staff. That's a blessing. Amen, that's a blessing. When you walk in obedience to God, it don't matter what it look like, it don't matter what other people think or what other people say. When you walk in obedience and faithful to God, God will blow your mind. God will, again, exceed your what you can imagine or what you can even speak. God will do greater. And I just want to thank God for planting the Newman family. They have some awesome, awesome children as well. Maya, she's going to be a great, great, tremendous blessing. Y'all already know it. She's going to be a great, tremendous asset, amen, in your ministry. She's going to bring in those youth. She's going to bring in those youth. Amen. Youth minister, youth minister, youth minister, youth minister, youth minister, in the name of Jesus. And little talent as well. Amen. We thank God for the Newman family and what God is getting ready to do in and through and by their lives and their ministry in St. Louis and beyond. Now Faith World Ministries. Did you say international? Incorporated. Okay, Now Faith World Ministries, but you might later on might want to add on international. Yeah, that's coming. That's coming. Amen, but praise God. And so, just for our viewing audience, amen, we thank God for you. We appreciate you. So if the Lord delays his coming and the creek don't rise, Remember, God loves you. I love you. And there ain't a thing you can do about it. God bless you. We love you.